So let's get started with a paper that we have read for this, the first task, which is the reflection paper for the class activity 3. So the main topic of our paper that we choose was wavelet pooling for convolutional neural networks. So convolutional neural networks have been around for a while now, but the success of the convolutional neural networks came into highlight after the paper AlexNet was proposed, and it basically showed everyone the power that the convolutional neural networks convolutional neural networks have in the computer vision domain. So there have been a lot of advancements in the CNS, and a lot of models have been proposed, and a lot of different techniques have been proposed. But one of the very important integral parts of CNNs is that they look at local regions of an image to produce the next layer output. So if we think the important things that differ the CNN from a normal FCN are having common kernel filters and being able to utilize the power of locality information in the locality of the data. So here the convolutional neural networks have one problem, the problem being two problems, for the first one being the computational cost, and the other one being the receptive field. So and over here we are going to be talking about mainly the receptive field part in this paper. And these the authors of this paper have tried to solve this problem using the technique of DWT. So the important property of DWT is that it is invertible, and this is what is helpful in preserving the detail texture when we are using multi-frequency feature representation. So this is a key concept that helps preserve the information when we are pooling from one level to another level. And that's why the authors have used this technique. The main contributions of this paper are that they have proposed a small but very effective modifications to the CNN, which leads to huge increment in the receptive field with decent enough computational cost trade-off. And another thing is that they have obtained state-of-the-art performance in image denoising. Single image super resolution, JPEG image artifact removal, and classification.
So, I will just give a small overview of the previous work to which the authors have compared their work on MWCNNs, which are multi-level wavelet convolutional networks, too. So, they use their network for a variety of tasks, which Abhiraj mentioned, which are image denoising, super resolution, and artifact removal, and classification. So the first three tasks come into the context of image restoration. For this, there have been several previous works which try to either denoise an image which has large amounts of Gaussian or impulse noise, which is image denoising, SISR, which is single image super resolution, which means that we have to upsample an image without any other information or with minimal other information, JPEG artifact removal, which is JPEG, as you know, is a technique to compress images, and when we decompress the images, there are various kinds of artifacts depending on the compression factor we use. So removing them is also a big problem, and CNNs have shown very promising performance, and they also test their network on this. And classification, which is just basically telling what type of image is presented to a CNN. CNNs have, before the advent of this wavelet pooling, CNNs have performed very well in all of these, but they have nevertheless faced hurdles in several of these and are not yet perfect. Even after this modification, they are not yet perfect, but the modification of wavelet pooling helps a lot in image restoration and a slightly less, but it still helps in classification. In classification, they test their method on several different CNN architectures. For classification, there are many architectures like ResNet or VGG, and they test their wavelet pooling on many different architectures just by using their small proposed modification and applying it to different CNNs and testing how much of an improvement. And their wavelet pooling method has consistently worked across architectures to give a better results due to their better receptive fields. I will start with summarizing some part of the paper with some theory first. So in our class, we have mostly studied wavelets in the context of time domain signals, which are unidimensional signals. But images are typically two-dimensional signals. They have an X and Y domain, and here we do not care that much about causality as we did in the time domain. So in such an image, the simplest wavelet transform is not only a two-band transform, like in the time domain, it was just a high-pass and a low-pass filter, the Haar filter bank. Here, the 2D Haar transform instead has four components, FLL, FLH, FHL, and FHH. So these four, I can call them sub-bands, correspond to firstly, FLL means the low pass in both the X and Y domains. FLH means a low pass filter applied in the X domain and a high pass filter applied in the Y domain. Filters can be applied independently in both X and Y. And FHL is a high pass in the Y and a low pass FHL is a high pass in the X and L and low pass in the Y. And FHH is a high pass filter in both domains. So the simplest filter is the 2D Haar wavelet, just given by these matrices. Here even the filter functions will be 2D. This is just an averaging of all the pixels. This is just taking difference in the Y domain and averaging in the X domain. So low pass in X and high pass in Y. And similarly, we can just make out for FHL and FHH too. So how do we apply this 2D wavelet functions? We just convolve it with the image. There we can do a 2D convolution, which is the basis of convolutional neural networks for image processing. So it is easy to implement. It is an easy modification to make in a CNN, because in CNNs also we usually just convolve different filters. So here we just need to convolve and then followed by a downsampling of two. And this downsampling of two means in both X and Y. So similarly, we can get all the four subbands. And the thing to note is that after getting the discrete wavelet transform, we can get the original image via the IDWT without any loss of information. So the traditional pooling methods which are used in convolutional neural networks, like max pooling, which is just taking the max out of, for example, four pixels, those do not retain all the information. You cannot obtain the original image back from after doing those kinds of pooling. So that is a critical difference between the wavelet pooling and the older pooling methods. So also additionally, in terms of analysis, we can view the wavelet pooling operators as a non-learnable or a constant filters. So in a CNN is basically a set of multiple learnable filters where you learn the exact filter weights, and in that sense we can view the wavelet transforms which we applied as only a set of non-learnable filters. So I think Abhiraj will continue with explaining the model architecture.
Yeah, so about the model architecture, so if we take a look at the figure one, so in this figure, the first A part of the figure basically shows us how the DWT, taking DWT gives us four subbands with four subbands of the same image with downsampled versions. So initially we have a full image h by w image. After we pass it through the DWT, we have h by 2 into dw by 2 image, and the channels are spread. But now we have four channels, and if we continue doing so, then we after each step we increase four channels and decrease the size of the image by 2. So this is basically how the multi-level wavelet decomposition can be represented, and the inverse is basically applied to get back the original image that we have. So the model that the authors have proposed is to basically put the CNN blocks within this in between these DWT blocks. So this is on a simple level, this is what their architecture is doing. So and now if we take a look at the figure 2, so this figure 2 basically is the actual model that the authors of this paper have implemented. So we see that what they have done over here is to basically use a unit architecture, which is a very standard architecture in deep learning, and what they have replaced is in the architecture at every downsampling step, they have replaced the max pooling, which we conventionally have, max pooling or mean pooling layers that which we conventionally have, with that of the DWT layers. And for the on the upsampling side, they have replaced the deconvolution layers with that of inverse wavelet transform layers. Another change that they have made is to reduce and increase the number of channels after each DWT or IWT step, which is not what is present in the a normal unit layer. So what this particular step is useful for is that it will help us model the dependencies between different frequency bands of an image. So if a particular band is important for classification of a particular type of objects, then that band is given more importance, and this is completely learned by the model. The next big change is to replace the skipped connections, replace the skipped connections by from concatenation to summation. So this was basically the model that they have proposed, and if we want to extend it for classification, it is very easy to do so by just replacing the downsampling layers with that of this particular DWT layers. The MWCNN model was mainly used for image restoration and super resolution, so that's why there they have also incorporated IWT layers. But in general, for classification, where we only need to do feature extractions, we won't be using the IWT layers. So now we move on to the discussion part. In this discussion, the main point that they have emphasized on is that how general their method is. So they have proved this by showing that this method that they have proposed for DWT is basically just encloses the other methods that are currently being used. So to prove this, they have shown that average pooling and dilated filtering can be expressed in terms of DWT. So if we first have a look at average pooling, if our input image is XL, if we take our input image as XL minus 1, then the output image after average pooling will be XL, where each pixel will have the value as we would obtain from this particular expression that we have over here. So if we take a closer look, this expression is basically this expression is basically the output of the low pass filter, which is FLL that we had before, which is just 2x2 matrix of all ones. So we can see that the average pooling is just a part of DWT, and DWT is much more than that of average pooling. One important thing to note over here is also that we are losing information in average pooling, but that is what is not happening in DWT. So if we now if we take a look at dilated filtering, in dilated filtering, what is happening is the authors have proven that this dilated filtering is basically a combination using a combination of low pass and high pass outputs convolving with a common kernel function, which is K, what they have called over here. So this is also we can see that this is also related to our DWT, as here also we have expressed the final operations that we can perform in terms of XLH, XLLL, XLHH, and the two terms that we obtain. So this basically tells us that the proposed technique is much more general, and thus also seems to perform better or comparable to that of the current techniques that we have. Yeah, so I would request Shubhang to continue with results part now.
So knowing that our technique is much more general and encompasses all other techniques, so it should also empirically demonstrate its superiority. So we go on to the results, where we see that in a variety of tasks, it actually performs better than several state-of-the-art methods. So just some remarks about how their testing environment. They use a single GPU and they train their MWCNN using the ADAM optimizer, which is one of the most popular optimizers used, and which is used by basically all of the state-of-the-art papers which come out today. And so the first task they evaluate is the image denoising task, where they compare with several different techniques, yeah, which are based on CNNs and also to some classical techniques. So they show that for different levels of noise in the image, this is basically sigma of the Gaussian noise, and on different data sets, they obtain the best performance they obtain better performance than all other methods. So you guys can have a more detailed look at the tables. I won't be going into the details. The second task is the single image super resolution task, where given a downsampled version of the image, you have to predict the image in full resolution. So as you can see from the visual results, this is the ground truth, and this is the result from our wavelet pooling network. While all the other tasks fail to give as good an image as the wavelet pooling network. The authors theorize that this is due to the information retention capability of the wavelet pooling networks, which they have proposed. And similarly, they test their method for JPEG artifact removal, where they test their method on different data sets, where they use the different Q factors. The Q is the quality factor, which decides the compression in the compression ratio for JPEG. And they try to remove the artifacts using different state of the art methods. And here too, our method, the wavelet pooling method, performs very well. And in all these three tasks, the authors theorize that it is probably due to the information retention capability of the DWT and versus the other pooling methods. Here, in all of these tasks, the retention of information is very critical, and the having a large receptive field is also very critical. So the next task is the image classification task. Here too, the authors actually use the older CNN models and just replace the pooling layers with the wavelet pooling layer, and they show that on different data sets and using various different architectures, just replacing the pooling layers, they obtain slight gains in accuracy. So here the gains might not be as large as the other tasks, because here the benefits of having a larger receptive field or of saving information are lesser, but nevertheless they give some gains in the inaccuracies. Also, we read an interesting paper on another paper on wavelet pooling for classification, where they show that even discarding some of the subbands, the high HH level subbands, even if you discard them, even then we have some gains in accuracy in classification. That is also an interesting paper to be explored. They claim that it is the most of the gains of the wavelet pooling is due to the receptive field. So that is something which can be more empirically explored. So in addition to that, we present some other possible extensions for the wavelet pooling method, which has been proposed by the authors by asking a few questions. Abhiraj will continue with the questions which are yet to be answered about this method.
Yeah. So we see that this particular method could be extended in six different directions. And the first question that we asked is, can CNNs learn DWT and IWT? So what we want to know from this question is that, is it possible for us to make CNN filters which learn the DWT and IWT, DWT and IWT filters? So for this, we propose the experiment that we will replace the pooling layers of the convolutional neural net with that of learnable 2x2 kernels and with a stride of 2, and then compare the results of that kernel, compare the results of that network with that of our DWT network and also the standard pooling techniques. So the hypothesis here being key, it is if the CNNs can learn DWT, then it would basically give an empirical evidence to the statement that given enough data, the neural networks are universal approximators. So this is the first experiment that we think could be interesting. The second one is, does lossless downsampling help in getting more effective knowledge distillation? So recently there has been a huge interest in small models which give very competitive accuracies to our current state of the art models. So one way of achieving this was using knowledge distillation, where a large model, by large model over here I mean a model having a lot of parameters, is used to train a small model, which can be used in small devices and is computationally very less has very less cost as compared to the large one. So we think that the property of the information loss not happening in DWT could be used in building such knowledge distillation models, where we use the intermediate layers of the large model to filter out the information and then feed it to the small models to get to train them in a much more efficient way and to obtain the accuracies that the large model is obtaining. So the third question that we want to ask is, can GANs benefit from a regularizer based on DWT? So what GANs are is that GANs basically, or we call them the generative adversarial networks, are very interesting neural network architecture that has came into came up recently, but yeah, in deep learning times that's actually a bit late, but anyway, what's the use of GANs? So GANs are basically can be used to generate fake data, which is quite believable, and in today's world we need today's world for training deep learning architectures we need a lot of data. And for some domains, it won't be possible to generate that much amount of data. take an example of medical imaging itself. It is hard to get that much amount of data from the patients, as it is as the main reason being the feasibility of it. It's very costly to generate that data. So we expect that GANs could be improved by using the DWT, as in GANs we can pass the final input image while training GANs. We can pass the input image and its low downsampled version using the DWT and train it with using the difference between the downsampled version of the original image and that of the generated image. So these two can be combined to get a loss value, and this loss value can be used to regularize our GANs. So this we expect this to help GANs in generating much more realistic images than currently that are present. So now Shubhang will explain the last three points that we have over here.
So another question another area where the wavelet pooling networks can help is in the area of data efficient deep learning. So can the wavelet pooling layers benefit tasks like few shot classification? So few shot classification is a relatively new area in deep learning, which aims at making neural networks learn a new task at using a very few images. So neural networks typically require millions of images, or at least hundreds of thousands, but few shot learning aims to make them use tens of images or of the order of 100 images. But the paradigm is based on the fact that many different tasks require the same kind of features. For example, if our network knows how to discriminate between a cat and a dog, then it should not require a million more images of a tiger to recognize a tiger. Probably only 100 images of a tiger should be enough. So that's what few-shot learning or data efficient deep learning aims to solve. And wavelet pooling can definitely be a very strong candidate for improving few-shot learning, because in few-shot learning, the problem with using a lot less data is that the neural network features, the CNN features, they are not able to adapt well to the new data. And in addition, there is a lot of pooling and max pooling and average pooling going on. So if we have only 100 images or very less amount of data, then our layers would not be able to learn that well to compensate for the information loss going on in the pooling layers. And so that's where the wavelet pooling can come into picture. The wavelet pooling can at least help the network to not learn to compensate. So the network would not need to learn to compensate for the information being lost. Also, additionally, the wavelet pooling would help provide the network with automatically good features which have already been learned, because wavelet domain is a domain which has been known to be a good domain to represent natural images. So it has been used in JPEG 2000 and several other areas where only the top few wavelet coefficients are shown to have most of the information of an image. So this can help the CNN directly get good features from an image of a new class, and it will ease out the learning task of a few shot learning network. This is a very exciting area to be explored. And another area where wavelet pooling can be used is the task of segmentation, the semantic segmentation task, where we have to provide a label to each pixel about whether it is a foreground or a background, or for in the context of self-driving cars, whether it is a pedestrian or is it a street sign. So here, the property of the wavelet pooling that it is invertible and it preserves information is very important, because in traditional methods, for example, if I use average pooling or max pooling, then I need to get a pixel wise output. So in a CNN, after the layers give me a small output, which is then upsampled using bilinear interpolation or some other techniques. this is what traditionally happens in segmentation CNNs, but this isn't very good because doing bilinear interpolation would just be sacrificing accuracy, or just be sacrificing the performance. So instead, if we could use wavelet pooling, which can help reconstruct the image in a proper manner without using any interpolation or approximation based techniques, then it would truly benefit segmentation, the task of semantic segmentation. It's a very hot area right now due to the hype around self-driving cars. Also, another question which needs to be answered, or another some interesting experiments which can be done, is trying different wavelet bases for wavelet pooling. Here they have only used the simplest HAR 2D basis with such a simple function, but for different tasks it might be that some other basis like the Mexican hat wavelet or some other wavelets might be more suitable for analyzing certain types of images, and they might give better features for certain type of images. So exploring in that direction might be a good idea. And even for the other tasks, trying other wavelet basis except the HAR 2D wavelet basis is a good idea to look at. So we are done with the presentation, but if anyone has any questions about it, please contact me or Abhiraj on MS Teams via chat.
Yes, thank you guys. We had a great time reading this paper, and quite interesting paper. And yeah, we expect to let's see if we get such interesting paper for the second reflection paper as well. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I think we can stop recording also.